Hachette Audio presents Stalin's War, A New History of World War II, written by Sean McMeekin, read by Kevin Stillwell. Introduction. Whose war? For Americans, Australians, Britons, Canadians, and Western Europeans, the global conflict of 1939 through 1945 has always been Hitler's war. Depending on taste, the story begins with the Versailles Treaty of 1919, or Hitler's ascension to power in 1933, based on German resentment of that treaty, or the German remilitarization of the Rhineland in 1936, or the Munich Conference of 1938, or Kristallnacht in November 1938, or Hitler's invasion of Rump Czechoslovakia in March 1939, and the British guarantee to Poland, or in the most literal version, the German invasion of Poland on September 1, 1939. But it always centers on Hitler as the villain who gives the struggle meaning. In popular culture, the Nazis are the perennial foils in an unbroken sequence of movies, from those produced during the war itself, such as Casablanca, 1942, to modern films, such as Inglourious Basterds, 2009. In politics, the Nazis are cudgels used to beat political opponents. To compare someone to Hitler is the ultimate insult. No one actually defends Hitlerian Germany, outside of parodies like Mel Brooks's The Producers, 1967, and much revived. But Hitler still haunts our nightmares as an all-purpose boogeyman, with remembrance of the horrors he unleashed, uniting us in denunciation of fascism, anti-Semitism, racism, and other evils of Nazism. There has always been something missing, though, in this Hitler-centric view of World War II, which rings hollower the further east one travels from Berlin to Beijing. In Eastern Europe, German aggression left behind much less of a trace than the Stalinist variety, which outlasted it by decades. East of the Volga, it left virtually no trace at all. In Asia, where Hitler's Germany was not even an active belligerent, the Soviet legacy of the war lives on in the communist governments of China, North Korea, and Vietnam, countries on which Hitler's short-lived Reich left not even a shadow. Nor did Hitler play a role in the Pearl Harbor attack in December 1941 that brought the United States into the war, even if Hitler made it easier for the Roosevelt administration to choose a Germany-first strategy when he foolishly declared war on the United States after Pearl Harbor in solidarity with Japan. In Putin-era Russia, although communism has been repudiated, Stalin and the Great Patriotic War loom larger than ever in popular memory as a hard-fought Russian victory against fascism, in which Hitler himself, unlike in Western histories, is often out of focus. Viewed from Beijing, Pyongyang, Hanoi, Moscow, Budapest, or Bucharest, the conflict we call World War II was not Hitler's war at all. It did not begin in September 1939 and end in May 1945, with victory parades and flowers and kisses for the victors. In Eastern Europe, the war lasted until 1989, in the form of Soviet military occupation. On the Korean Peninsula, in China and Taiwan, questions arising from the conflict remain unresolved. It has always been a stretch to lump together all the wars on the globe between the Japanese invasion of Manchuria in September 1931 and Japan's final capitulation in September 1945, as many historians are now conceding. Victor Davis Hanson's recent general history, The Second World Wars, illustrates the point, as does Anthony Beaver when he opens his own history, The Second World War, by conceding that it was an amalgamation of conflicts. It is even more of a stretch to blame them all on one man, a man who was not even in power in Germany when the Manchurian conflict erupted, and who had been dead for 4 months when Japan surrendered. Still, if we do wish to find a common thread linking the on-and-off global wars lasting from 1931 to 1945, It would make far more sense to choose someone who was alive and in power during the whole thing, whose armies fought in both Asia and Europe on a regular, if not uninterrupted, basis for the entire period, whose empire spanned the Eurasian continent that furnished the theater for most of the fighting and nearly all of the casualties, whose territory was coveted by the two main Axis aggressors, and who succeeded in defeating them both and massively enlarging his empire in the process, emerging, by any objective evaluation, as the victor inheriting the spoils of war, if at a price in Soviet lives, nearly 30 million, so high as to be unfathomable today. In all these ways, it was not Hitler's, but Stalin's war. If Stalin's imprint on this global conflict is most obvious in the broad lens, it is no less visible in narrow focus. The Japanese incursion into Manchuria in September 1931 was an escalation in a long-running struggle with Russia, first Tsarist, then Soviet, over control of Manchuria and its key ports and railways. Stalin had deployed 100,000 troops in Manchuria as recently as 1929 to secure the main railway lines, and would maintain troops on and sometimes inside the borders of occupied Japanese Manchukuo all the way until August 1945, when Soviet troops invaded Manchuria and expelled Japan for good. Even in the critical days of late August and early September 1939, Stalin was driving events. It is widely known that the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact of August 23 gave Hitler a free hand to invade Poland without fear of hostile Soviet intervention. It is less commonly known that the Germans were expecting the Red Army to invade Poland simultaneously to claim Stalin's share of the country, or that Stalin's share was larger than the Germans. Instead, Stalin waited until Poland's armies had been destroyed before authorizing the Red Army to move in, even then denying that the USSR was at war with Poland to escape the odium of being Hitler's co-belligerent. Nor was the resulting partition of Poland Hitler's idea. It was Stalin's. Floated as a trial balloon in 1938 to lure Germany to the negotiating table. The European war that broke out in September 1939, pitting Britain, France, and Poland against Germany, with the USSR claiming to be neutral, did not have Hitler's planned or desired lineup of belligerents. He had sincerely believed that France and Britain would back down, as they had done when he had confronted them over Czechoslovakia. Nor did this war serve genuine French or British interests, as was made clear both in the dilatory approach to fighting it these powers took, which left Poland alone on the battlefield in 1939, and in the final reckoning 6 years later, which left the French and British empires in ruins and Poland under Soviet domination. But it was precisely the war Stalin wanted, even if, owing to German operational elan and Western ineptitude, it did not turn into an indecisive war of attrition, bleeding both sides equally, as in 1914 through 1918, that the Soviet dictator would have preferred to see. To argue this, as I do in the audiobook that follows, is not mere speculation. Stalin's dialectical view of Soviet foreign policy, in which metastasizing conflict between warring capitalist factions would enable communism to advance to new triumphs, was firmly rooted in Marxism-Leninism, based on the precedent of Russia's own experience in the First World War, and clearly and consistently stated on many occasions, both verbally and in print. To understand Stalin's approach to the world does not require fancy ideological footwork or special insight, but simply to read his words and evaluate his actions in light of them. It asks us to spend a small fraction of the energy historians have devoted to divining Hitler's ideology, strategic thinking, and war aims to those of Stalin, the man who bested him decisively. Now that the Russian archives are mostly open, including the Politburo special files, with dozens of Soviet document collections in print, full of original material and priceless revelations, and with a growing body of secondary literature based on this new material, There is no longer an excuse for the enduring Hitlerian hypermnesia in the historical literature on World War II, and the concomitant neglect of the enormous Soviet part in the drama. We have all the information we need to reevaluate Stalin's role in the conflict, from its origins, through the years in which it tilted ever more favorably to Soviet interests in Europe and Asia.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.